Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 30A, Marius. Last week, we ended with the death of Gaius Gracchus, the popular reformer who was driven to suicide in 121 BC. This week, we will take up the career of a man who coincidentally served as tribune of the plebs the very next year. He would not make his name in that office or that year, but 20 years later, he would be known to history as the great remaker of the Roman legions and the man who was consul 5 times in a row. What the Gracchi had started by flouting the laws against consecutive terms, Marius took to a higher office for an even longer stay. Gaius Marius was born in 157 BC in southern Latium. His hometown had been conquered by the Romans in the 4th century BC, and since that time, they had been citizens of Rome without voting rights. It wasn't until about 30 years before Marius' birth that his people were granted status as full Roman citizens. The story goes that Marius was the son of a simple farmer. But this myth of humble origins was an invention after the fact to help the poor of Rome identify with Marius, the great general and politician. His father was certainly involved in farming, but he was likely a major landowner who had numerous familial and commercial ties to the nobility in Rome. There is no other way to explain how Marius was able to get his foot in the door to high Roman office. The other great myth of Marius' early years was that as a teenager, he came across an eagle's nest with 7 chicks inside. Eagles were seen by the Romans as sacred animals looked after by Jupiter himself. Though again, this myth did not begin making the rounds until years later, especially after Marius began running for his 7th consulship, and it was impressed upon the people that it had all been preordained by Jupiter himself. Elect Marius, he once saw 7 baby eagles, and he's only been consul 6 times. Get it? You don't want to go messing around with the universe, do you? When Marius came of age, he volunteered for service in the army and was placed as an officer. Though this placement hints that his family was well connected, he was never truly accepted by his noble peers. To them, he would always be novus homo, or a new man, meaning that none of his ancestors had ever served as consul. Despite all the power, wealth, and fame he acquired over his career, to the old guard he would always be a new man, much the way that in England, no matter what Margaret Thatcher did, said, or achieved, she will always be just a grocer's daughter to the aristocratic class. Some ceilings simply cannot be broken through. Though this very status as a new man would solidify Marius's near sainthood in the eyes of other ambitious young men who could not trace their family trees back to Romulus. As a young man, Marius was stationed with Scipio Aemilianus in, wait for it, Numantia, just like our old friends the Gracchi brothers. In 134 BC, he ran for and was elected one of 24 military tribunes for the Spanish legions. He was an unknown candidate, but had a stellar service record to present. Unable to trade on his name, Marius traded on his skills and accomplishments. What a concept. This began Marius's slow and sometimes agonizing climb up the Roman political ladder. At each rung, he was resisted by the old guard, who were never quick to embrace new men. So unlike many other great figures in Roman history, his elections were never a foregone conclusion. In 120 BC, though, the year after Gaius Gracchus's turbulent final term in office, Marius was elected a tribune of the plebs. He was able to do this by securing the blessing of a noble named Quintus Metellus. Though only 3 years older than Marius, the Marii family had long been clients to the Metelli family, and the old client-patron dynamic played out. Once in office, though, Marius infuriated his patrons by helping pass an election reform law the Metelli opposed. The bill, and I am not making this up, required a narrowing of the passageways electors walk down on their way to the ballot box to prevent harassment by partisans for one side or the other. The lofty ideals of democracy are often reliant on such micromanagement. The price of freedom, it seems, is eternal vigilance over the width of hallways. His relationship with Metellus strained, Marius's career stalled. Though after a few years, he stepped up another rung and managed to get elected praetor, despite charges of ballot fraud. I guess it doesn't matter how narrow a passageway is if the man walking down it is going to cast 50 votes. Marius served in Spain with some distinction for a few years, and then returned to Rome, where he married the aunt of yet-born Julius Caesar. I have to apologize for conflating Marius with Cinna at the end of last week's episode. Marius was Caesar's uncle-in-law, not father-in-law. The marriage was a boon to Marius' career, and earned him a whole host of new allies amongst the elite, and around 110 BC, he even patched things up with his old patron Metellus. At this point, I would like to shift gears before we move into the next stage of Marius' life and give a little background on where he and Metellus are headed. In 119 BC, the son of Massinissa, the old Numidian ally of Rome from the Punic Wars, passed away. He left the kingdom to his two sons and a third adopted son named Jugurtha, who was technically the dead king's nephew. All three were grandsons of the great Massinissa. Jugurtha did not like to play nice with the other children, though, and immediately set about running the other two out of town. He assassinated one, but the other escaped and fled to Rome. Concerned at the power struggle in their client state and the economic disruptions caused, the Romans sent a delegation to find out what the trouble was all about. When he was a young man, Jugurtha served in Spain as a cavalryman alongside the Romans and had noticed the most glaring weakness of the legions, the ease with which its commanders could be bribed. Military commanders at this time, no longer fighting for survival, were clearly in it for the money and prestige, and saw no important distinction between plundering by force and accepting bribes not to plunder. In fact, the latter seemed far more cost-effective. Of course, to the Romans, the idea of bribery was officially morally reprehensible, but this fact had little impact on commanders in the field. So when the Roman commission came to adjudicate the budding civil war in Numidia, Jugurtha bribed them handsomely to decide the issue in his favor, which they promptly did, being men of honor. Left alone and in control of half the kingdom, Jugurtha set about attacking his cousin brother to win the other half. In this struggle, the Italian merchants and citizens came down almost universally against Jugurtha, who was causing a lot of trouble and disrupting trade. In retaliation, Jugurtha took the provocative step of executing a number of Italians in his custody. The Senate could not stand by and let this go, so they sent an army to deal with the upstart. But the Roman armies were able to do little against Jugurtha. Suspiciously little. At once, an investigation was undertaken into accusations of bribery, and Jugurtha, still technically a client of Rome, was summoned to account for himself. But a few well-placed bribes later, Jugurtha was on his way back to Numidia, free as a bird, and no finding of fault being handed down on anyone. You gotta hand it to him. There is something poetic about bribing your way out of charges of bribery. But the Roman people were still up in arms about the barbarian king, and in 109 BC, the consul for the year, Marius' old patron Metellus, was sent to Numidia to put down what had become a full-fledged rebellion. He took along Marius to serve as chief lieutenant. The campaign was frustrating for both sides. Metellus was too honest to be bribed, and realizing this, Jugurtha kept to the mountains and away from the invading legions. The Numidians took a page from old Fabius the Delaire and embarked on a war of attrition with the Romans. Metellus was never able to pin the African prince down, and his troops and the public back home began to lose patience. Accusations of bribery were hurled at Metellus, and though innocent, his own perceived failure became damning evidence. Marius watched with frustration equaling that of the Roman people. He thought Metellus far too cautious, and began to get the idea that he could do a better job. To curry favor with the troops, he relaxed discipline in camp, and began letting it be known that if he were in charge, this war would be over in a week. Troops and traders both began to write home praising Marius to the sky, and a groundswell of support began to coalesce around the confident lieutenant. Marius asked permission to return home and stand for the consulship. Metellus disapproved of the idea, but knew the troops were getting restless, and it wouldn't do anyone any good to have Marius sulking around camp stirring up trouble, so the consul let him go. Marius came back to Rome and campaigned on a platform denouncing the slow pace of Metellus' strategy. He spoke confidently of his plan for victory, which involved aggressive scorched-earth tactics. The public, wary of corrupt officials prolonging the war, swept Marius into his first consulship in 107 BC. The Senate was not exactly pleased at the do-gooder Novus Homo, who was about to spoil all their fun, and while accepting his election, attempted to deny his appointment to command of the Numidian legions. The People's Assembly, however, countered the move by invoking a little-known clause that gave them final say over a consul's placement in the field. Marius was given Numidia and tasked simply with following through on his promise to end the war. To accomplish this goal, Marius asked permission to raise his own legions. This permission was granted, but then Marius asked for an exemption from the rules governing recruitment. The number of men who qualified under the old census rules had dwindled to a bare few, even after the property qualifications had been lowered and lowered again, until they practically did not exist. The army Marius raised for the Numidian campaign, while the logical conclusion of years of rewriting the rules, nonetheless marked a clear break with the past. There would be no property qualifications this time. Any citizen was eligible, landowner or not. The floodgates were open, and the poor citizens of Rome flocked to join Marius's new army. Though the move was supposed to be a temporary measure that affected only this specific levy, there was no turning back. Henceforth, the ranks of the legions would be filled by the poorest of the poor, not the richest of the rich. The elites had grown tired of the burden of military service anyway. They had plush estates and Greek philosophy to read. Let the rabble risk their lives in the provinces. It might clear off some of the excess population, and besides, it gave the poor something to do besides railing against their injustice of their lot in life, which was becoming such a bore. Let the beggars be soldiers. Whatever. It was a fateful moment that greatly accelerated the path to military dictatorship and imperium. From here on out, poor citizens became career soldiers, promised a salary while they served, and a plot of land when they retired. To most it seemed too good to be true, and in many cases it was, as the state reneged on land grants and was often slow with paychecks. Soon enough, the interests of the soldiers no longer aligned with the interests of the state, and generals who could deliver land and pay gained the loyalty of the men who now looked at the Senate as a bunch of crooked old liars. And we all know where that road will take us. But the immediate issue was the war in Numidia. Marius took his newly minted soldiers to Africa and promptly delivered on his promise, though it wasn't scorched earth brute force that carried the day, but rather a little backroom treachery of his own. After finding it was not as easy to bottle up Jugurtha as he thought, Marius dispatched one of his lieutenants to a neighboring kingdom to convince the local king, the father-in-law of Jugurtha, to betray the rebellious prince. Through a mixture of bribery and cajoling, the young lieutenant was able to pull it off, and the king delivered Jugurtha to the Roman delegation in chains. Their general captured, the Numidian army surrendered. Because he held imperium over the war, Marius received all the credit for his lieutenant's actions. There was nothing really improper or unprecedented about this, but it did stick in the craw at the young officer, who Marius failed often to even mention as he described how he won the war. The incident would mark the beginning of a rift between Marius and the young officer, a man named Lucius Cornelius Sulla. That rift would soon open up into a chasm, and the two men would stand for years on opposite sides of a bitter and often bloody conflict that presaged the full-blown civil wars of the following generation. But while Sulla's star was still on the rise, Marius was burning at its absolute brightest. Next week, he will check off baby eagles 2-6 and break every prohibition in the book doing it, serving as consul an unprecedented 5 consecutive years. In that time, he would fundamentally reshape the organization and composition of the legions, turning them from a part-time army into a fully professional fighting force. All the drilling and conditioning Marius put his armies through was essential as, to the north, an old menace was rising again. Suddenly, the complacent Romans, who had spent the better part of a century fighting wars of choice and conquering the Mediterranean with ease, suddenly found themselves facing a war of extinction. The Gallic nightmare, long dormant, was back with a vengeance, and it would take everything the Romans had just to hold them at bay, let alone conquer anything. Hello, and and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 31B, Marius. Last week, we covered the life of Gaius Marius through his first consulship. Up to this point, his career was impressive but hardly unique. Yes, he was a new man and deserves extra credit for forging his way upward despite the institutional barriers he faced, but he was hardly the first nobis homo to be elected consul, and hardly the first Roman general to win the support of the Roman people by bringing an unpopular foreign war to an end. But Marius's ambition, and more importantly, his willingness to act on that ambition, definitely set him apart from his colleagues. There is a reason Gaius Marius deserves multi-episode treatment, and by the end of today, those reasons should be abundantly clear. In 109 BC, the consul Metellus had been sent to Africa and took Marius along with him. But in that same year, Metellus's consular colleague, Marcus Solanus, was sent north to deal with the Cimbri, a Gallic army that had been growing in strength in the north. Solanus was supposed to put down the impertinent barbarians and restore Roman order, but instead was utterly defeated. Emboldened by the Cimbri success, another Gallic tribe began making waves in 107 BC, the year of Marius's first consulship. Again, the Roman legions were sent north to put down the marauding army, but again, the legions were beaten. This time, the Roman officers left standing were only able to save their defeated troops by having them pass under the yoke, a humiliating ritual for the proud Romans. At this point, the most pressing matter was the war in North Africa, but it was fast becoming apparent that Rome faced a very real threat in the resurgent Gauls. In 106 BC, the Romans met with some success as their consul for the year, Quintus Capio, pacified a rebellious town and reintroduced some semblance of Roman superiority. But he was to give it all away the next year, leading to the circumstances that allowed Marius's unprecedented run of consulships to commence. In 105, Capio was made proconsul in Gaul, and the new consul for the year, Gnaeus Mollius, was sent north with an army to join him. Mollius, like Marius, was a new man, and the noble Capio had little interest in serving with, let alone serving beneath, the new consul. The Cimbri were on the move again, and had been joined by another of the migrating Germanic tribes, the Teutones, on the east side of the Rhone River. Mollius crossed over with his army, but when he engaged the tribes, Capio refused to come to his aid. Only after special pleading from the Senate did Capio agree to help the consular army. Even then, he refused to join his forces with Mollius's troops. As a result, the Cimbri and Teutone turned first on Capio's smaller force and drove him off, and then they swung back on Mollius, who was pushed back to the banks of the river. With nowhere to run and no reinforcements to speak of, the Romans were crushed, with casualties running upwards of 80,000. The entire debacle was chalked up in the Roman press as another example of the haughty oligarchs disrespecting anyone who did not come from their close caste. Capio would not have left a patrician cousin out in the cold like that. It was only because Mollius was nobis homo that so many good Roman sons and husbands were dead on the banks of the Rhone. The popularity of the patricians was at an all-time low. So in 105 BC, the people turned back to another nobis homo, a man who had proven his ability to succeed where the supposed elites had endlessly failed, Gaius Marius. The election itself was illegal, of course. There were at least two, and possibly three different laws, placing various restrictions on when a man could be consul, how many years must pass before he holds office again, and possibly whether holding office a second time was ever permissible. But the laws were flouted, and the rule of law gave way to popular sentiment. Marius was stationed in Africa at the time of his election, and returned to take up a mantle he had just set down 2 years before. Upon his return, he celebrated a triumph for his victory in Africa with the chain Jugurtha at the head of his procession. The spectacle climaxed with the execution of the rebellious African prince. No bribe would save him this time. Marius's first order of business was to whip the legions into shape. The army sent north had been sloppy and undisciplined, and Marius had no intention of repeating the mistakes of his predecessors. He again raised a levy without regard for property qualifications, but then took things one step further by reorganizing the basic structure of the army to meet his own specifications. It was this extra step that really secured Marius's place in history. Because in doing so, he would completely abandon the maniple system and the traditional three lines that had served the army so well over the past 200 years in favor of a more robust and more mobile legion. The armies of Caesar, Pompey, and Octavius were all structured according to the Marian vision. The first thing Marius did was abolish the maniple as the basic tactical unit. Too often, the checkerboard maniples had proved insufficient against a direct frontal assault. Plus, when not facing a lockdown phalanx, it was easy for a single maniple to be surrounded and cut off from the rest of the legions. So Marius took what had once been merely an administrative classification for three maniples, the cohort, and made it the basic tactical unit. Now, rather than 160 men marching off together, the tactical box was made 400 to 500 men strong. While enlarging his tactical forces, Marius also made a decision to abandon the traditional three-line formation. It really speaks volumes of Marius's self-assuredness that he would so casually shrug off an organizational structure that had conquered most of the known world. Some would call it outright arrogance, but all his alterations were made with an eye on the coming battle with the Gauls, a campaign that would involve a lot of headlong charges from a numerically superior force. There was no sense letting the drama of having the inexperienced first line push back only to have the waiting-in-the-wings veteran step in to save the day. He eliminated the division of age and mixed old and young into his new cohorts. He then arrayed them in three lines, a nod to the past, but drilled his troops on rapidly cycling forward, not waiting for one to be pushed back before the other stepped up. The idea was to always keep the freshest troops on the front line, have them fight like mad for a few minutes, and then go to the back and let another line step in. Hockey coaches the world over are all heirs to the Marian legacy. But Marius did not stop just with how his army fought. He also changed the entire outlook of what it meant to be a soldier. Previous armies took seriously the responsibility of combat, but left the actual packing of equipment around the world to slaves and pack animals. The baggage trains had become unwieldy, and the number of camp followers had grown to ridiculous proportions. With poor men serving year-round at his disposal, Marius simply ordered that the troops themselves carry their own equipment. It's not like they were going to argue and go home to their farms if they didn't like it. He force-marched them around Italy with 70-pound packs until they gained the strength and stamina to move quickly without worrying about a miles-long donkey train. The nobility derisively referred to the soldiers as Marius's mules. But by a factor of 10, the marching and drilling with oversized packs left Marius's legions in the best shape of any Roman army in history. In sheer stamina, they could not be matched, and when it came time to fight, they could simply outlast an enemy who put all their energy into an initial charge. Finally, Marius rebranded the army as a career choice, not just a temporary obligation for men with better things to do. He made statutory land grants to men who served their full 20 years of service and regulated dispensations of food, clothing, armor, and weapons. Marius also began to actively promote from within, taking the best of his foot soldiers and making them officers when they displayed courage and initiative. These commissions, of course, came at the expense of the young nobles, who had long been accustomed to simply stepping into positions of leadership without any real battlefield experience. The move at once made the army better, made the men love Marius, and hacked off the old patrician order. But the hurt feelings of the nobility was of no consequence to Marius, and he was single-minded in his pursuit of recapturing the glory of the old Roman legions. They had been the best for years, but were dangerously close to letting it slip away out of complacent laziness of the patrician elites. The Gallic armies waiting in the north would not simply lay down their arms because some 10th generation Claudii led the army, and to Marius, that was all that mattered. The Cimbri and Teutoni, of course, made all of these reforms possible by simply cooling off their offensive for a few years. The Cimbri had decided to try their luck in Spain, while the Teutoni laid low in southern Gaul for a few years. Marius was returned for a third consulship in 103 BC to continue his reform efforts of the legions, and when that term expired, he sought office again, not wanting all of his efforts at reshaping the legions to be wasted by some new consul who did not understand what Marius was trying to accomplish. Plus, he had been preparing for a great showdown with the Gauls, and frankly, they were not playing their part very well. Marius had put a lot of effort into building an army that could defeat them, and now he wanted the credit and glory he felt he deserved. In 102 BC, in the midst of his fourth consulship and third in a row, the barbarian tribes finally obliged and set about planning invasion of Italy. Though the Cimbri and Teutones combined to form an army a staggering 200,000 men strong, they made a critical error and decided that instead of overwhelming the Romans in a single mass onslaught, they would divide and invade Italy on two fronts. It may have looked good on paper, but it let the outnumbered Romans off a rather large hook. With the barbarian army divided, Marius could focus on one, then the other, without ever facing the insurmountable odds that an army of 200,000 men presented. The Cimbri circled around and were set to come into Italy through the Alps from the northeast, while the Teutones were to come in along the Mediterranean coast. Marius sent a force under his consular colleague's direction to delay the Cimbri's passage through the Alps, while Marius himself took his new toy into France to head off the Teutones before they ever got to the mountains. Further tribal recklessness led to another piece of good luck for Marius. A contingent of 300,000 Germans broke out ahead of the main barbarian army as soon as they caught sight of the Romans. Marius was able to rout this charge with ease and place half a legion behind some nearby hills before withdrawing. The rest of the Teutone army marched forward in pursuit, and when they had passed the hidden cohorts, Marius turned and attacked. All their attention forward, the barbarians never saw the 3,000 Romans emerge from their hiding place. Unsure of who or what was attacking them from behind, the barbarian army became a mass of confusion, which Marius easily exploited. The Teutone army was annihilated. Things did not go smoothly against the Cimbri, however. The other consul for the year had been unable to hold them back, and by the end of 102 BC, Italy found itself playing the unwilling host to 100,000 barbarian invaders. In the elections that year, Marius was again returned as consul. No sense in getting off the horse in midstream. In the summer of 101, Marius led the horse safely to the other side of the river, meeting and defeating the much larger barbarian army. All the drilling and marching proved the difference against the far larger but far less disciplined hordes. Marius returned to Rome and celebrated his second triumph. At this point, only Scipio Africanus loomed larger in the Roman imagination than the great Gaius Marius, who was now the hero of two separate wars against two completely different enemies. Sure, there was grumbling in the upper classes about this commoner who seemed to be making himself king, but the danger was as real for them as it was for the lower classes, and Marius proved himself more than up to the tasks for which he had been assigned. So they held their noses and cheered along with everyone else. Out of gratitude for his success, Marius was made consul for the fifth time in a row in 100 BC. It may have been one consulship too many, however, as a bit of Marius's popular luster wore off. Grain prices were on the rise again, and tribunes, taking a cue from the Gracchi, were agitating for relief. Unrest began to ripple through the city, and the Senate ordered Marius to do something about it. Seeing the immediate expediency of restoring order to Rome, Marius complied, but it pitted him against the popular assemblies who had done so much to lend credibility to his never-ending reign. At the end of the year, Marius decided that enough was enough and announced his retirement from public life. If the story had ended there, Marius would have already secured his place in history as one of Rome's greatest and most famous leaders. But he was not done yet. Next week, the old man will be pulled out of retirement to deal with the inevitable result of Roman mistreatment of their Italian allies. In what would become known as the Social War, Marius would again fight alongside Sulla, his perennial lieutenant, now a general in his own right. The Social War would be the last time the two fought on the same side, and the intense rivalry between the two men would soon erupt into a bloody back and forth of purging and counter-purging that shocks the conscience even today. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 32, The Social War. After his final consulship in 100 BC, Gaius Marius returned to a self-imposed exile, and it appeared that the great general had left the public stage for good. 10 years of relative peace followed, until, in 91 BC, Rome was once again threatened by a hostile enemy, triggering Marius' return to the familiar territory of war and politics. This time, however, he would not be fighting Numidians or Gauls. Rather, he would be fighting the very men who helped him to defeat the Numidians and Gauls. Some of them, anyway. The Roman-led Italian Confederacy, which had endured now for hundreds of years and had stood firm even against the clever might of Hannibal Barraca, whose entire strategy hinged on bringing about its dissolution, was finally breaking apart. The second-class status afforded the Italian allies finally became intolerable, and rather than making obviously just concessions, the tone-deaf Roman Senate took a hard-line stance, initiating what was to become known as the Social War, when a collection of Italian allies would break away and form an independent state. After 2 years, the Italians would finally be granted their simple request to be treated as equals. But of course, those were a bloody 2 years. The war served no one's interests and should have never started. Just another example of unnecessary carnage brought about by short-sighted pig-headedness. Trouble had been brewing for years. The fight for full Italian citizenship had picked up momentum during the tribunates of the Gracchi, but the Senate had always managed to block the extension of suffrage, more concerned with the immediate political expediency of denying the Gracchi and their allies a victory than actually addressing whether or not the policy was right or wrong. In 91 BC, the flint was sparked again by a tribune named Marcus Drusus. This time, the kindling lit, and pretty soon a full-scale bonfire was raging. In the past, the confederate arrangement between Rome and the allied Italian cities had served everyone well. The Italians were nominally independent, but were required to provide troops to serve in the legions if Rome required it. In return for their troop levies, the Italians had always shared generously in the spoils of war and found their formal taxes kept to a bare minimum. But in recent decades, while their commitment increased, by the turn of the first century BC, fully 65% of the raised legions were composed of non-Roman Italians, war booty was increasingly held by the Roman leadership. This began to irk the Italians, but they had no official way to address the situation and had no say in the election of the consuls, who had now grown accustomed to giving their allies the shaft. Their attitude grew steadily worse after Marius eliminated the distinction between Roman and non-Roman legions. Indeed, Marius famously stated that in the din of battle, he could not tell Roman and ally apart. So here they were, literally fighting side by side with the Romans, but taking home an increasingly reduced share of the profits. Many assumed after Marius's reform that citizenship would soon follow, leaving them bitterly disappointed when the Senate refused to take up the issue. Finally, in 91, a tribune named Marcus Livius Drusus introduced legislation aimed at providing full equality to the Italians. Oddly enough, Drusus was no radical populare. Indeed, his legislation was aimed at diminishing the ability of rabble-rousing tribunes to sway the hordes of Rome against the Senate, who Drusus saw as the true defenders of republican virtue. By introducing more level-headed middle-class Italians into the electorate, Drusus hoped to shift power away from the populist demagogues who had only the narrow interests of their constituents at heart. The Senate didn't pick up on the vibe Drusus was laying down, however, and immediately opposed the idea. They were confident in their hold on power and didn't want to introduce an unstable element into the equation. Besides, they might start peeling off some of those riches the senators had been hoarding for themselves. So, oblivious to their own long-term self-interest, a cabal of patricians conspired to put a stop to Drusus. First they killed his legislation, and when that didn't seem to work, they simply killed Drusus. For the Italians watching from the sidelines, the assassination of Drusus was the final straw. They really thought that this time around, the Senate would listen and make them full equals. The dead tribune's body, however, told them everything they needed to know. The time for drastic action had arrived. One by one, Italian cities began to openly declare that they no longer bore any allegiance to Rome, and henceforth would be completely free and independent. At the vanguard of this movement were the Samnites, one of Rome's oldest foes, who had never fully gotten over their final defeat some 200 years earlier. In Rome, the news was greeted with furious disbelief. To them, the issue of who ruled Italy had been solved at the close of the Samnite Wars. But the disbelief did not delay their actions, and legions were immediately raised to put the upstarts back in their place. Across Italy, though, town after town joined with the anti-Roman confederacy. The only region to remain steadfastly in the Roman camp were the Latins. Everyone else, it seemed, was going to take their shot at independence. It did not, however, turn out to be a very good shot. In the city of Corfinium, which lay across the Apennines due east of Rome, representatives of the various Italian cities gathered to formalize their alliance. They renamed Corfinium Italica and declared that it was the seat of a new government based on the Roman model, complete with its own senate and assemblies, but completely free of Roman rule. The immediate business of the new Italian government was the very war their existence had sparked. The Romans were not going to take this rebellion with grace and good humor, so preparations had to be made to withstand the inevitable onslaught. The Romans, quick with the rod, sent their consular armies out in opposite directions in 90 BC, one north and one south, to put the revolt down. To the north went the consul Publius Rutilius, who coaxed out of retirement his famous relative Gaius Marius to act as a military advisor. It didn't do much good, though, as Rutilius quickly led his army to a series of blundering, mistake-prone defeats. Finally, the consul made his one positive contribution to the war effort by getting himself killed. After the consul's death, Marius stepped into the leadership vacuum and quickly had the northern Italians on the run. With the situation in the north for the most part well in hand, the focus of the Romans turned south, where they faced the horrible deja vu of crossing swords with the dreaded Samnites. Lucius Julius Caesar, the consul leading the Romans in the south, and the elder relative of a 10-year-old boy named Gaius, found the Samnites no less fierce an opponent than when last they met in battle. Caesar, along with his fellow commander Lucius Cornelius Sulla, watched in vain as the Samnites sacked a number of Roman towns. But they were finally able to halt the advance and keep the Samnites bottled up while Caesar returned to Rome to oversee the consular elections. But before he left office, Caesar laid the political foundation of the war's end. The Senate, understanding now that citizenship was inevitable, passed the Lex Julia, granting citizenship to those Italian cities who had not joined the rebellion, and offering it to any Italian currently in revolt who laid down his arms. The vast majority of Italians, to whom independence had been an unwelcome state anyway, jumped at the chance. But the Samnites and a collection of tribes in the north continued to hold out. In 89 BC, Sulla was given full command of the southern troops and showed himself to be a brilliant tactician and leader of men. After saving a besieged legion at the city of Nola, Sulla was awarded the grass crown by the grateful soldiers whose lives he had saved. His fame was growing, and, to the people of Rome, Sulla emerged as the clear hero of the social war. This did not sit well with Marius, who had been maneuvered out of his command in the north when the Senate, afraid of the old consul returning to the political arena, gave the north over to Capio, the son of the consul who had left Mollius out to dry during the war against the Gauls. But when Capio fell in battle, Marius was sure he was destined to return to Rome the triumphant hero. But the Senate again thwarted him and sent the consul Pompey Strabo, the father of Pompey the Great, north to take over. There was little Marius could do, and he was forced to play a subordinate role as Pompey laid a brutal siege to the town of Asculum, which was the last city in the north holding out. Once Asculum fell, the back of the resistance had been broken, and the fight went out of the Italians. By this time, most of them had already given up anyway, content with the fact that they had achieved exactly what they wanted and would soon be full equals in a united Italy. Sulla wrapped up the last pockets of resistance in the south, and the brief social war was over. As a footnote, I should mention that during these years, a young noble named Cicero was punching the clock on his brief military career in order to qualify for the political career he really wanted, fighting both under Pompey Strabo and Sulla. Cicero had no taste at all for battle, and never made any secret that he disliked war. In later life, he was given a statue of Mars by a friend to add to his growing collection, and Cicero wrote in reply, "Why send me a statue of Mars? You know I'm a pacifist." But from 90 to 88 BC, young Cicero did what he had to do and slogged around Samnium, knowing that no man in Rome could hope to lead without a few war stories to make him credible. Another young noble who cut his teeth during the social war was Gnaeus Pompeius. Though his attitude towards battle was much more in keeping with the Roman tradition than the bookish Cicero. Only 17 at the time, he was called to action in 89 BC to serve with his father in the north and was presumably present during the siege of Asculum. The young Pompey, if Plutarch is to be believed, already had an air of greatness surrounding him, and his fellow troops made comparisons to young Alexander the Great and Scipio Africanus. Pompey and Cicero had little in common personally, but in 40 years, the two men, all grown up and having reached the pinnacle of the political ladder, would find themselves on the same side of a bitter civil war against a man who at the time of the social war was only 10. I often think that this was about the only time Pompey and Cicero would have proved a match for Julius Caesar, who, in his good time, would both outfight Pompey, Rome's greatest general, and outpolitic Cicero, Rome's greatest politician. But how were they supposed to know that? By the time Sulla remarked that in the teenage Caesar he saw many a Marius, it was probably too late. Remember, though, that sometimes the best way to win is to make sure that your opponent is still a child. The social war was paradoxically both a war of unification and the last time for 70 years the Romans themselves were truly unified. In 88 BC, just as the Italian allies were being officially enrolled as full Roman citizens, Sulla was elected to his first consulship. In itself, it seemed a natural and innocuous choice. He was, after all, the hero of the most recent war, so who better to lead Rome? Besides, in the east, Mithridates, the king of Pontus, was hatching the first of his seemingly endless merry-go-rounds with the Roman legions. Who better, then, to march out and face this new threat in the east than the great Sulla? Well, according to the aging Marius, he was. And the old general became convinced that it was his destiny to lead the legions in the east. Unfortunately, he couldn't convince anyone else to back him. And why should they? Sure, he had been great in his prime, but it was a different age, and it was becoming clear that Marius was borderline senile and clearly unable to wrap his head around the fact that the world was moving on without him. Sulla was young, dynamic, and clearly represented the future of Rome, so he was unanimously chosen to head up the armies headed east. Marius, bitter in defeat, decided that rather than go out quietly, he would order his hardcore partisans to do everything in their power to reverse the decision and place Marius himself back in charge. Sulla was forced to flee the city and made his way to the encamped legions, most of whom were loyal veterans of the social war. But though he briefly held on to power, Marius's desperate, selfish grab triggered a wholly unprecedented response from Sulla, who did not take his eviction well. Pretty soon, word reached Marius and his partisans that the aggrieved consul was on his way back, at the head of a full consular army. Sulla, it seemed, was marching on Rome. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 33, Marius and Sulla. After emerging as the hero of the social war, Lucius Cornelius Sulla had been elected consul in 88 BC. With the brief civil war put to rest, Roman attention was immediately diverted east, where Mithridates IV, king of Pontus, was threatening the newly incorporated province of Asia, located on the far side of the Aegean. Trouble had been brewing for years, and in 88 BC, Mithridates did not simply cross the line, he jumped over it. After several run-ins with the Roman legions garrisoned in the east, Mithridates decided that the Westerners had to go and Anatolia should be returned to her native people. To this end, he initiated a mass slaughter that was to become known as the Asiatic Vespers. Enlisting the help of locals in cities across the Turkish peninsula, anyone who so much as spoke with a Latin accent was targeted for death. Over 80,000 Roman citizens and allies were murdered across the east, coinciding with the king's invasion of Asia. The Romans were justifiably horrified and immediately raised an invasion force to avenge the slaughter. Sulla was the natural choice to lead the invasion, but old Marius had his mind set on one last fling with glory, and arranged for the Senate's choice of Sulla to lead to be annulled by the people's assemblies. This annulment was guaranteed when armed gladiatorial bodyguards in the employ of Marius and his allies literally threw senators out of the Senate so a quorum could not be reached to overturn the decision, to overturn the original decision the Senate had come to originally. The introduction of mob violence into Roman politics precipitated by the Gracchi was starting to become less and less an exception, and more the rule. Sulla was forced to flee for his life and made his way to the army encamped along the Adriatic. The army was ready for the planned invasion, but before they sailed east, Sulla would march them west. He incited the troops, most of whom were loyal to Sulla anyway, into a frenzy over the anti-democratic thuggery of Marius. Ready to follow Sulla anywhere, the consul pointed them towards Rome and announced that with their help, he was going to evict Marius from the city. His officers were appalled. It was illegal for the legions to cross the traditional city limits of Rome, and as much as they disapproved of Marius, they simply could not abide by Sulla's brazen flouting of the law. When they reached the city, all but one of Sulla's officers, a close lieutenant named Lucullus, refused to cross the line. Sulla respected their decision, but was not dissuaded from his plan, and took the troops right into Rome. Inside the city, Marian partisans organized gladiators and slaves into a defense force, but they were no match for trained legionnaires, and in the brief street fighting that ensued, Sulla's army had no trouble turning the pathetic defenders to heel. Marius himself barely escaped with his life and fled, along with his son, to Africa. Sulla restored order to Rome, had Marius declared an enemy of the state, and put the Senate back in control of the city. All of this drama filled the entirety of Sulla's year as consul, and it wasn't until 87 BC that he was actually able to lead his army out of the city to the east, where they should have already commenced the retaliatory campaign against Mithridates. But the minute Sulla left town, Marius began to plot his return. Many in Rome, who had been ambivalent in the political showdown between Marius and Sulla, had been pushed over to the Marian camp by Sulla's completely illegal and immoral seizure of the city. In 87 BC, the people of Rome did themselves no favors if they hoped to keep turmoil in the city to a minimum by electing as co-consuls Gnaeus Octavius, a staunch conservative and Sulla partisan, and Lucius Cornelius Cinna, a populare who was fast becoming the leader of the anti-Sulla forces in Rome. While not necessarily pro-Marius, Cinna nonetheless saw an alliance with the old general as an advantageous way to box out Sulla's allies. Throughout 87 BC, Octavius and Cinna clashed repeatedly, until Cinna was driven out of town by an angry mob. Once outside Rome, Cinna immediately began gathering men who were to help him fight his way back to power. Marius, meanwhile, was raising an army in Africa with the intention of following the precedent Sulla had just set by marching on Rome and capturing the city. When Marius crossed the short span of the Mediterranean back into Italy at the head of a loyal army, Cinna saw an opportunity to strengthen his own position. He formally joined with Marius, and the combined forces stormed into Rome. What followed was five straight days of terror and bloodshed. Marius simply released his army inside the city with orders to kill anyone allied with, or suspected of allying with, or suspected as having the same name as someone who was allied with Sulla. Noble families fled or fought depending on their disposition. Captured Sulla partisans were killed and their heads were displayed in the forum. Finally, after 5 days of unchecked violence, Cinna could stand no more and ordered his own troops to put a stop to Marius's men. The army from Africa was ordered to stand down, and those who refused were killed by Cinna's troops. Order finally restored, elections for next year's consulships were held. That Marius and Cinna were elected came as no surprise to anyone. Everyone who opposed them was either dead or fled. For Marius, the election to his seventh consulship fulfilled the promise of his legendary encounter with the seven eagle chicks so many years before. Satisfied that his destiny had been met, the old general died in 86 BC, just 2 weeks after his election, leaving Cinna in sole control of Rome. While all this drama was unfolding back home, Sulla was off in the east leading the effort to repacify Greece. Mithridates had overrun the province of Asia and had made the Greek cities along the Aegean coast his accomplices in the mass murder of Latins in Anatolia. Welcomed as a liberator, the king pressed his luck by going one step further and attempted to push the Romans out of Greece altogether. In his effort, he was backed by the Armenian kingdom, which was reaching the zenith of its own power. Combined, the two hoped to retake the eastern Mediterranean from the alien Westerners. The ensuing war with Rome would have far-reaching consequences. Rather than being pushed back to where they came from, the Romans wound up planting their standards even further from home. When Sulla crossed over to Epirus in 87 BC, he found that Mithridates was well on his way to turning the Greeks against Rome. In Athens, a puppet tyrant had been installed and was backed by a Pontic army, led by Mithridates' most able general, Archelaus. This would be as far west as Mithridates would make it, however, as the mere sight of the 40,000 Roman soldiers was enough to convince the remaining Greek cities to remain loyal. Sulla's first order of business was to bring Athens back into the Roman fold. When he arrived, though, the city was obstinate and shut its gates, so Sulla was forced to sit back and lay a siege. While encamped outside the city, refugees from the Marian Reign of Terror began to trickle in, and Sulla first received the news that Marius had returned to power and that he had been officially exiled from Rome. He maintained his focus on the task at hand, however, and for the rest of the year and through the beginning of 86 BC, Sulla remained at the gates of Athens. Finally, in March of 86, the vigilance of the Athenian defenders waned, and Sulla stormed the walls in a midnight raid. Once inside, Sulla was not feeling particularly generous and did nothing to rein his troops in. The slaughter was only halted after Greek friends of Sulla begged him to stop the carnage. The Pontic army under Archelaus had sailed north, and Sulla left Athens to lick its many wounds. On his way out the door, however, Sulla set fire to the Athenian port of Piraeus, a final reminder of what happens to those who stand against Rome. Sulla caught up with Archelaus north of Athens in the Greek province of Boeotia. The Pontic army by this point numbered 120,000, three times larger than the Roman legions chasing them. Sulla studiously avoided being drawn into a fight until he found terrain that would mitigate Archelaus's overwhelming numerical advantage. Finally, at Chaeronea, Sulla found his spot. He lured Archelaus into attacking when the Romans held fortified high ground. With Sulla personally dashing from wing to wing to keep up with wave after wave sent in by Archelaus, the Romans outlasted the increasingly stretch-thin Pontic army. Seeing a shot, Sulla charged and chased the opposing army back towards their camp, encircling them before they reached home base. The final casualty figures showed that while the Pontic army had been slaughtered, the Romans emerged from the battle practically unscathed. With this smashing victory in Greece, Sulla remained as popular as ever with the people of Rome, despite the continuing hostility from the elites left in the city and the fact that he technically was an exile. Cinna was re-elected consul in 85 BC and decided that Sulla needed to be formally relieved of duty, not because there was any doubt he would triumph over Mithridates, but because there was no doubt he would eventually triumph over Mithridates. And that victory would leave Sulla, unquestionably, the most powerful man in Rome. So Cinna raised an army and placed men with strong anti-Sulla passions in charge. They were to find Sulla, relieve him of his command, and combine the two armies. However, when the army led by Lucius Valerius Flaccus and Gaius Flavius Fimbria arrived in camp beside Sulla's army, things went backward. Sulla encouraged the new arrivals to defect over to his side, and pretty soon, the new army was hemorrhaging troops. Flaccus, unable to make Sulla stand down, led his army north, officially to track down the army Mithridates himself was leading towards Greece, but unofficially, to simply distance himself from the seductive charisma of Sulla. The dissension in the ranks spread, however, and the remaining troops soured on Flaccus. Eventually, his second-in-command Fimbria led a mutiny. Flaccus was murdered and Fimbria took over. But being a staunch Marian partisan, the new leader had no intention of joining with Sulla. He just wanted to take Mithridates himself and steal Sulla's thunder. Sulla himself remained behind in Boeotia, readying himself for the rematch with Archelaus, who was being reinforced from the east by the Armenians, and soon was back at the head of an army again numbering more than 100,000. The two sides met at Orchomenos, but the outcome was no different this time around. The superior tactical ability of Sulla, which was executed by the far more disciplined Roman soldiers, was too much for the Pontic army. Once again, Archelaus was forced to make a run for it as Sulla annihilated the army he left behind. After crossing the Hellespont into Asia, Fimbria found Mithridates and fought a limited battle that saw Rome get the better of the Pontic king. But without support from the Roman navy patrolling the Aegean, Mithridates was able to slip away from Fimbria. The navy, led by Lucullus, Sulla's most loyal officer, was not about to come to the aid of a political enemy. Mithridates, however, could see the handwriting on the wall, and in late 85 BC, he offered to come to terms with the Romans. The Pontic king met with Sulla, much to Fimbria's dismay, and peace terms were hashed out. Mithridates was to remain in control of Pontus, but had to otherwise withdraw his forces from every other region he occupied. Rome would move in and occupy these territories, extending Roman dominion even further into the east. The territories that had rebelled and the newly acquired regions were forced to pay a steep price for challenging Rome. Not only was the annual tax burden increased, but Sulla demanded 5 years' worth of back taxes at the same rate. The financial punishment left most of Anatolia deep in debt and unable to direct their wealth towards any other end than paying back Rome. This, in addition to filling Rome's coffers, kept them from making further mischief. With the war against Mithridates settled, Sulla returned to his war against his domestic political opponents. Fimbria, who had taken command of the province of Asia, was of immediate concern. The mutinous general talked a good game, but the minute Sulla crossed the Hellespont, Fimbria committed suicide, knowing he was no match for Sulla and would likely be executed one way or the other for his actions. With the east fully pacified, Sulla began to strategize about a return to Rome. Cinna, who had effectively run the city for the past few years unopposed, was well aware that if Sulla came back, the party would come to an abrupt end. Taking advantage of some minor commotion in Illyria, Cinna raised an army to quell the unrest. The fact that Illyria lay directly between Sulla and Rome had nothing to do with Cinna's desire to march an army there, of course. In his haste, bordering on panic, to get his army in place, Cinna, however, pushed his troops too hard, force-marching them through snowdrifts to reach Illyria in time to block Sulla's path. In one of history's little twists of fate, Cinna's soldiers mutinied and stoned the four-time consul to death. The path to Rome now lay open, and hearing the news, Sulla immediately ordered his troops to head home. Sulla, it seemed, was marching on Rome. Again. There will be no episode next week, as I will be spending the weekend moving across town. But in 2 weeks, we'll return for Sulla's second march on Rome, the crowning of Rome's first dictator for life, and, inexplicably, the retirement of Rome's first dictator for life. Hello, and welcome back to the History of Rome. It's been a while, I know. So let's quickly recap where we're at. In 85 BC, Sulla won his war in the east against Mithridates and came to terms with the rebellious king. While the war in Asia unfolded, Sulla had been too busy to worry about the fact that technically he was in official exile from Rome, a consequence of his political struggle with the now dead Marius and the soon-to-be-dead Cinna. But having emerged victorious abroad, it was time to turn back to his domestic political problems. Cinna, who had been in sole control of Rome since Marius' death 3 years earlier, knew that Sulla's imminent return did not bode well for him, his career, or his life. So he organized an army to stand between Sulla and Rome. But in his haste to block Sulla, Cinna pushed his own troops too hard and was murdered in a mutiny in 84 BC. So that's where we left off, with Sulla preparing to march back to Rome, and, well, let's pick it up there. Inside Rome, news of Sulla's imminent return was met with panic. Please recall that during Marius and Cinna's reign, most of the Sullan supporters had been purged, so the state was staffed with fierce Marian partisans who dreaded the return of their mortal enemy. In anticipation of a coming battle, the consuls chosen for the year 83 BC were both fierce opponents of Sulla. They were also, as it would turn out, no match for him either. Sulla was able to cross the Adriatic unopposed and landed in the heel of Italy at the head of 5 legions. Both consuls raised armies to prevent Sulla from moving north. Gaius Norbanus finished his preparations first and marched quickly, intent on bottling up Sulla where he had landed. But his army was made up of fresh recruits, and he himself was not a general anywhere near his rival's class. Sulla blew through Norbanus without breaking a sweat. The defeated consul was forced to flee with the remainder of his army to Capua. Next, the other consul, Cornelius Asiagenus, marched south at the head of his army to see if he could do any better. But he didn't even get as far as Norbanus did. Upon intercepting Sulla, Asiagenus' army began defecting in droves to Sulla, and the consul was forced to surrender without ever drawing his sword. To the Roman aristocracy, it was not hard to tell which way the wind was blowing, and many nobles who had done their best to ride out the troubles in inconspicuous neutrality now began to openly break for Sulla. The governor of Africa, for example, Metellus Pius, a highly respected general in his own right, took it upon himself to throw Marian partisans out of his province and thus deny Sulla's enemies a source of recruits and supplies. Within the city limits, however, it was still dangerous to support Sulla, and one last round of violence against his allies swept through the city. But this would prove to be the final death throes of the Marian power structure, and soon enough, they would find themselves reaping what they had sown. In addition to Metellus' support in Africa, Sulla also found support in Spain from Marcus Licinius Crassus, who, in due course, would become the richest man of his time and one of the 3 triumvirs. Crassus marched an army east to Italy, where he planned to aid Sulla win control of Rome. The second of the 3 triumvirs, Pompey Magnus, also decided his ambition was best served by throwing his lot in with Sulla and, raising an army of his own, announced his intentions to fight for the exiled general. We will get to the 3rd triumvir, young Julius Caesar, in a moment. Near the end of his term in office, the consul Asiagenus, who had been set free by Sulla, led a new army against the 23-year-old Pompey, who had positioned himself in North Italy. The consul clearly had no wish to relive the embarrassment of losing his army without a fight to the charismatic Sulla. Asiagenus, however, having the misfortune to be merely a leader in a time of extremely charismatic leaders, wound up in exactly the same boat he had found himself in before when he reached Pompey. His army defected en masse, and the consul was once again forced to flee without an army left to lead. As 83 drew to a close, the Senate leadership knew the noose was drawing close around their necks. So, along with one of Cinna's old co-consuls, Papirius Carbo, they elected 26-year-old Gaius Marius the Younger in an attempt to boost the morale of his father's old supporters. But the younger Marius was not his father, and besides, it is doubtful even the old man in his prime could stop Sulla now. The campaign season of 82 opened with Metellus Pius arriving with his army in North Italy, where he rendezvoused with Pompey. The newly elected consul, Papirius Carbo, led an army north to face them, while Marius the Younger built an army to face Sulla, who, it was clear, would soon be marching on Rome itself. Marius found willing recruits among the Samnites, who feared the return to power of the reactionary conservative wing of the Roman aristocracy. They had only recently been granted full rights in the aftermath of the Social War, and had no intention of seeing their natural allies in Rome, the Marian Populares, ousted from power. Would the conservative Sulla rescind the suffrage they had so recently won in his inevitable post-victory reorganizations? They had no desire to find out. With the Samnites on board, Marius would now at least be able to make a go of it against Sulla, who thus far looked indestructible. But Carbo and Marius were simply not up to the task of warding off Sulla's onslaught. This was not to say they were not capable, just that they were facing some of the most accomplished generals in Roman history. In the north, Carbo was defeated by the combined army of Pompey and Metellus, and withdrew to Etruria, where he at least hoped to prevent them from marching on Rome. In the south, Sulla and Marius the Younger met and fought a prolonged battle, but as was the case throughout this civil war, defections cost Marius too many men, and he was forced to withdraw behind the walls of a local allied city. Leaving a siege force in place, Sulla marched north to Etruria, where he planned to crush Carbo and then sweep into Rome. Sulla, however, was unable to dislodge Carbo from his position, but it was clear to the beleaguered consul that he would not be able to hold out forever, and for all intents and purposes, Italy was in the hands of Sulla already. Rather than make a last stand, Carbo slipped out the back and fled, spending the next year hiding out in the small islands off the Sicilian coast. In November of 82 BC, an army of Samnites emerged to relieve Marius and his trapped army, but they were unable to break the siege. So the Samnite general tried a different tack and ordered his army to march straight for Rome. Dismayed that this enemy army was in a position to actually capture the capital city, Sulla swept in from Etruria to stop their advance. The two armies faced each other just beyond the Colline Gate in Rome's northwest quadrant. The ensuing battle was a massive and desperate struggle between two forces who felt their very existence at stake. No victor emerging from a civil war can afford to keep their rivals alive for long. Post-war purges are usually swift and brutal. In the Battle of the Colline Gate, Crassus famously secured victory for Sulla by routing the left wing of the Samnite line. Sulla's army was able to engulf the enemy and destroy them. In all, it is estimated that 50,000 died in the fighting. Marius the Younger, upon hearing the news, committed suicide while still under siege. Sulla now stood alone, the undisputed master of Rome. The victorious general and the cowed Senate that welcomed him into the city, though, were not content to simply let his newly won power go as a tacit understanding between the people and their new master. The nudge-wink dictatorships of Marius and Cinna would not do for Sulla, and the Senate proclaimed him dictator. But this would be no standard-issue six-month constitutional dictatorship. No, Sulla's dictatorship, in an unprecedented development, would have no term limit. Thus, Sulla became Rome's first dictator for life, and the doomsday clock of the Republic moved closer to midnight. Though there were some high-minded reforms Sulla had every intention of carrying out with his newfound unlimited power, he began his reign in true Machiavellian fashion. Machiavelli, of course, advises that a prince who has entered office through revolution, conquest, or coup ought to first eliminate all rival claimants to the throne. If one succumbs to compassion too soon, those rival claimants will become centers around which opposition can rally, forcing the prince to initiate ever-escalating cycles of civil repressions that will make him unpopular with the people and lead to his downfall. Better to get all the bloodshed and terror out of the way early. That way there will be no opposition to worry about. The people will soon forget the initial horror and regard the later, mild disposition of the prince to be a true reflection of his character, and he'll remain popular and, most importantly, in power. Machiavelli pointed to the example of Sulla as the living embodiment of this theory. Dictator for life Sulla posted in the forum a list of Marian partisans, 1,500 men of the aristocracy he considered to be enemies, and therefore now enemies of the state. He announced rewards for killing or capturing the proscribed, among whom were 40 senators. In the reign of terror that followed, the murderous frenzy ultimately engulfed some 9,000 men, women, and children, most of whom had nothing to do with the rivalry between Marius and Sulla at all. Have you had your eye on your neighbor's house for a while? Want to get out from under a crushing debt? Want to bury a business rival? Well, Here's your chance. Just accuse your chosen victim of Marian sympathies, and voila, your personal beef now becomes state policy. The killing went on for months, and all of Rome lived in fear of waking up and finding their names on the prescribed list, either for real or imagined reasons. In a fun twist, there was also nowhere for the condemned to turn, as harboring the proscribed was itself a capital crime. One young man in particular found himself in this unenviable position by virtue of having married the daughter of Cinna. Young Julius Caesar hid out for months, hopping from house to house, sheltered by pro-Sulla relatives who begged the new dictator to allow the young man to live. Sulla eventually relented to their entreaties, but with famous reluctance. Sulla could see that the ambitious young noble was dangerous. In Caesar, Sulla said, he saw many a Marius. But with his stranglehold on power now secure, Sulla set out on the reforms he had been planning all along. A true conservative, Sulla had watched the transfer of power from the Senate to the Tribunate with disgust. Marius, the greatest of the new men, had been a patron saint of the unwashed masses. Sulla aimed to restore the natural order of things and put the Senate back in the driver's seat. Among the myriad statutory revisions he was able to enact by fiat, Sulla stripped the Tribunate of all the power it had acquired since the first secession of the plebs. He abolished their right to veto legislation. He abolished their right to introduce legislation without Senate approval, and then he doubled the ranks of the Senate, packing it with supporters, to ensure that no legislation was approved that did not have Sulla's personal favor. As a final blow to the once prestigious office, he declared that a man elected tribune was barred from running for any other public office for the rest of his life. Ambitious men were immediately diverted away from the Tribunate as a stepping stone to power, leaving the office deprived of both talent and power. Exactly how Sulla wanted it. But where would all those ambitious men go? Well, according to Sulla's new order of things, they would enter into the recently codified cursus honorum, literally translating into the course of honor. Prior to Sulla, the path to the consulship had had its traditional steps, but nothing was written in stone. Sulla decided now was the time to literally write the steps in stone, in part to ensure that the eventual leaders of Rome had the requisite experience necessary to handle the responsibilities of state, but also in part because he wanted to draw out the process. A certain ambitious 24-year-old general named Pompey was already beginning to fancy himself one of Rome's leading men, so Sulla moved the consulship, by law, at least 15 years in Pompey's future. The new path to power would start with at least 10 years of military experience, beginning when a man was 20 years old and eligible to hold the office of military tribune, a quasi-political leadership position within the legions. At 30, a man could stand for election as a quaestor, where they would serve either in Rome's financial institutions or as high-ranking aides out in one of the provinces. Quaestors were the keepers of the money, overseeing both military pay and the state treasuries, and as such, found themselves at the center of every important political battle, as all political battles are ultimately about money. If they survived the cutthroat world of high finance, a man could stand for aedile at the age of 36. The aediles were in charge of Rome's public infrastructure, the food and water, the public temples, the sewers, and the roads. Of critical importance for securing long-term public support, the aediles were also in charge of the public games. A man could make a good name for himself throwing lavish games, though in the process it was easy to go broke, and one might find it necessary to forge an alliance with a wealthy benefactor. The aedileship was not a required step, but it afforded the first opportunity for a man to become well known to the general public. At 39, if he had not gone broke entertaining the masses, one could become a praetor, of whom six were to be elected each year. The praetors functioned primarily as judges, overseeing Rome's complicated judiciary, but they could be assigned to lead armies or provinces and would, in the absence of a consul, hold imperium, granting them the final word in law and order, life and death. The final step was, of course, the consulship. The minimum age to hold this highest office was 42. You'll notice that the higher you ascend up the ladder, the fewer slots there are available at the next rung. If six patricians are all elected praetor at the age of 39, only two of those will be able to win the consulship at the age of 42. Thus, it became highly prestigious to attain the next office, quote, in your year. Cicero would often point to having achieved every office of the cursus honorum in his year as one of his proudest accomplishments. Now, obviously, not every man could pass through the entirety of this course, and one might be tempted to, say, hang out in the quaestorships for a while and build a base of power by controlling the purse strings. To prevent this, though, Sulla again brought to bear the oft-enacted but oft-ignored statute that a man must wait 10 years before holding the same office again. He also threw in the caveat that the year after holding a particular office, the official in question must spend a year in the provinces as a pro-praetor or a pro-consul or what have you. The intent here is obvious to physically remove the previous year's office holder from the city of Rome to prevent them from further cultivating any relationships they had acquired while in office. Sulla hoped that his reforms would put a stop to ambitious men skipping ahead in line or building independent bases of support from which they could launch attacks on the Senate and the Republic in general. Sulla honestly believed that he had made his own career an institutional impossibility and hoped to be the only dictator for life Rome ever saw. And speaking of dictator for life, in 80 BC, believing that he had set the ship of Rome on a safer course by re-empowering the Senate, Sulla announced that he would be stepping down from his office at the end of the year, and normal consular elections would resume. It was a decision that came as a shock to the entire empire, and a decision that Julius Caesar would never be able to fully wrap his head around, often mocking Sulla in later years for not realizing what he had had and for his naivete in believing that Rome had seen the last of its absolute dictators. Sulla was not quite ready for retirement, though, and decided to stand for election as consul the next year, and was, of course, elected. But after this year in legitimate office was complete, he really did retire to his country villa, where he worked on his autobiography and tended to his garden, leaving public life behind for good. Sulla was a complicated man, and his peaceful stepping away from power tells us as much about his character as his violent seizure of power a few years previously does. The bloodthirsty tyrant who had overseen the mass murder of over 9,000 people was also the humble old man who had given up power to retire in peace. Clearly, there is no putting a box around Sulla. He remains a singular figure in world history. He died in 78 BC, and his gravestone was marked by an epitaph he wrote himself, summing up his life as well as anything anybody else could possibly say would. No greater friend, no worse enemy. Seems to say it all. Sulla saw himself as a champion of the old order and believed that he had left Rome with the institutional tools it needed to prolong the Republic indefinitely. The Senate was back in charge, the populist demagogues were silenced, and ambitious men were no longer able to circumvent the traditional path to power, nor remain in power past their single year in office. But of course, all the revised statutes in the world could not distract from the very fact of his life and career. The last vestiges of the old republican virtue had been stripped away by his dictatorship, and all that remained was naked power, to be acquired by any means necessary. Most of Sulla's constitutional reforms would be repealed within a decade of his death, and within 3 decades, Rome would be engulfed in a war between the men who looked at Sulla's career and asked themselves, as Pompey did, if Sulla could, why not me? Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 35, Crassus and Pompey. In 78 BC, Lucius Cornelius Sulla died, believing that he had put the Republic back on track. Since the end of the Third Punic War 80 years previously, Roman politics had skewed more and more towards populist demagogues, blatant corruption, and a flouting of traditional virtue. Sulla, in his role as dictator, had gutted the power of the tribunes and put the Senate firmly back in control of state affairs. It is ironic that the supposed savior of republicanism had so completely eschewed democratic principles and the rule of law, but desperate times called for desperate measures. Besides, Sulla could always fall back on one of the first offenses a child ever learns to justify all of his extra-legal activities. Marius started it. But as I said at the end of last week's episode, no amount of constitutional reformation could divert the gaze of ambitious men from the facts of Sulla's life and the power he had won through brute force alone. Whatever had bound the leaders of Rome to the traditional republican governing apparatus and its built-in limits on absolute power had been shattered. The Gracchi had struck the first blow when they successfully introduced violence into the political arena. Marius hammered the point home when he brazenly stood for consulship after consulship, while Sulla himself landed the killing stroke when he had himself appointed dictator for life. The era of noble adherence to the rule of law was dead. The era of the naked power grab was at hand. Whatever great work Sulla accomplished in his life, saving the Republic was certainly not among them. Indeed, the generation that would kill the Republic grew up in the shadow of Sulla's dictatorship, and the ringleaders of its demise were some of Sulla's leading supporters. Two of those supporters, Marcus Licinius Crassus and Gnaeus Pompeius, would eventually forge an uneasy alliance with an up-and-coming popularia general named Julius Caesar to form the First Triumvirate, the vehicle through which the Republic met its demise. Marcus Licinius Crassus was born in 115 BC, making him 33 years old during the Battle of the Colline Gate, and the eldest of the three triumvirs. Crassus was the youngest of three boys, born into a well-bred plebeian family, and was descended from Publius Licinius Crassus, who, in addition to serving as Pontifex Maximus for nearly 20 years during the Second Punic War, also held the distinction of being Scipio Africanus's co-consul in the year 205 BC, as the great general made his preparations to win that long war once and for all. Their father had been consul in 97 BC, governor of southern Spain from 97 to 93 BC, and censor in 89. The Crassus family was wealthy and well-respected, but eventually ran afoul of the Marians during the upheavals of the mid-80s BC. Though they had supported Marius in the past, they attempted to hew a more neutral line in the struggle between the old general and his younger rival, and were marked for purging. One of Crassus's brothers had already been killed in the social war, but his father and remaining brother were caught up in the purges and were either murdered or committed suicide. Only Marcus escaped to carry on the family name, fleeing to Spain in 87 BC. In Spain, Crassus was able to hook up with clients his father had established while governor, and laid low while Cinna controlled Rome. It went without saying that when news of Sulla's return from the east reached him, Crassus immediately declared his support and left Spain, intent on helping Sulla drive the Marians out of Rome. He raised a small force and arrived in Italy around the same time as Metellus Pius had arrived with his army from Africa. Crassus fought alongside Metellus until they all merged into Sulla's army prior to the Battle of the Colline Gate. And it was in that battle that Marcus Licinius Crassus became a man in his own right and was no longer seen as simply his father's son. With Sulla leading the left side of the line, he gave Crassus command of the right. And as it turned out, Sulla found himself evenly matched and unable to break through the Samnite line. But Crassus routed his opposition and was able to wheel in and trap the remaining Samnites, winning for Sulla not just the battle, but complete control of Rome. He expected to be amply rewarded and praised for his early support and critical role in Sulla's victory. But in the first chapter of what turned out to be the defining story of his life, Crassus was overshadowed by the younger and more charismatic Pompey. Though mildly embittered by his perceived snubbing, Crassus had far more important things to worry about than why young Pompey had been granted a triumph, despite having never held a single office in the cursus honorum. I mean, he had never even been a quaestor, let alone a praetor, which was supposedly the minimum rank required for a triumph. And besides, he was what, 25? He couldn't stand for a praetorship even if he wanted to. But like I say, I don't care. I'm fine with it. I'm happy for him. Hooray for Pompey. Pompey the Great. Yeah, sure. Crassus didn't care at all. But instead of dwelling on Pompey, there would be plenty of time for that later. Crassus focused on rebuilding the family fortune, which had been expropriated by the Marians after his father's death. In this pursuit, Crassus showed both above-board shrewd financial acumen, as well as a penchant for ruthless below-the-belt profiteering. He gleefully entered the chaotic economic mess that arose from the sullen reign of terror. Having been a victim of the Marian purges, Crassus had little sympathy for the men who had killed his father and brother. Crassus was first in line to buy up whatever the proscribed left behind when they either fled the city or were murdered, and on at least one occasion, he added a name to the list simply because he coveted the holdings of an otherwise politically neutral rival. During Sulla's reign, Crassus bought and sold his way to the top of Rome's financial food chain, and after the dictator's death, he invested his profits in the slave trade and silver mines, where he doubled and then quadrupled his money. Eventually, he would become Rome's richest man and largest landowner. He never lost his lust for wealth, nor his cunning skill at acquiring it. For example, at the time, Rome had no formal firefighting service, so when Crassus learned through his citywide network of clients and informants that a building was on fire, he would arrive on the scene with hundreds of slaves in tow. With the house burning in front of them, Crassus would offer to put the fire out if the distraught owner agreed to sell the property. In these circumstances, Crassus was able, of course, to extract a ridiculously low price, at which point the slaves would indeed quell the blaze. Sometimes, though, the owner would refuse to sell, in which case Crassus would leave with his firefighters, allowing the house to be engulfed in flames. But these were the rare cases. Usually the owner sold, Crassus bought, and his private empire grew by another block. At the height of his power, Crassus is estimated to have been worth between $170 and $180 billion 2008 dollars. To put that in perspective, the richest man in the world today is Warren Buffett, who is estimated to have a personal financial net worth of around $66 billion U.S. To say that Crassus was absolutely filthy, stinking rich is an understatement. But he always carried with him something of an inferiority complex. In Roman culture, wealth may have been looked upon with envy, but rarely with respect or admiration. Respect and admiration were reserved for military heroes. His exploits during the Battle of the Colline Gate were always looked at sideways, as they came during a civil war and were achieved at the expense of fellow Roman citizens. If Crassus wanted to join the pantheon of great Romans, he would have to do better to win new territory for Rome or defend the empire from a dangerous foreign threat. Crassus spent his entire life looking for an opportunity to lead an army in the field, win a great victory for Rome, a triumph for himself, and the respect he felt he deserved. Eventually, this obsession would lead to his death in Syria, where he was killed still trying to find what he was looking for. On the battlefield, Crassus was simply unable to match the exploits of his contemporary rival and nominal ally, Pompey, who, much to Crassus's eternal bitterness, seemed to live a perpetually charmed life. From Crassus's perspective, no one got better press for doing less than Pompey. But there was nothing that he could do about it. So Crassus went through life known as Crassus Dives, or Crassus the Rich, whereas Pompey went through life known as Pompey Magnus, or Pompey the Great. And though the latter's nickname was originally thrown around as a sarcastic dig by his elders, Pompey eventually promoted the name as a literal title, and the people of Rome embraced it as such, much to Crassus's eternal dismay. Pompey was born in 106 BC, making him 9 years younger than Crassus and only 24 years old when Sulla won control of Rome. He was the son of the not-so-beloved Gnaeus Pompeius Strabo, or Pompey the Cross-Eyed. Pompey Strabo was the first in his family to achieve senatorial status and distinguished himself during the Social War, leading the victorious Roman armies in the north as consul in 89 BC. However, when you emerge from a war with the nickname the Butcher of Anything, you know that your tactics have been a bit harsh. So when Pompey Strabo, a.k.a. the Butcher of Asculum, died in 87 BC of the plague, his body was dragged through the streets by a joyously disrespectful mob. Not exactly the funeral procession one hopes for. But the sins of the father do not seem to have rubbed off on the son, and when Sulla returned from the east, Pompey raised 3 legions from the ranks of his father's veterans. The young man had served with them since his first campaign at the age of 17, so his father's soldiers loved and trusted the boy who had grown up in the barracks as one of their own. After helping pacify northern Italy, Pompey was next given the task of ensuring the loyalty of Sicily, which was still teeming with Marians. As I've mentioned numerous times, Sicily was the breadbasket of Rome, and controlling it was essential to controlling the empire. As long as Rome remained fed, the people were generally content to allow themselves to be led by whoever wanted the job. But if those grain shipments ever stopped, anarchy, as they say, was only 3 missed meals away. If the Marians controlled Sicily, they could wreak havoc on Sulla's attempt to consolidate power. Pompey threw himself into the task with a ruthlessness that reminded some of his father. He tracked down Papirius Carbo, the consul who had fled from Etruria at the end of the Civil War, and had him executed. When the people of Sicily complained that some of Pompey's methods were perhaps illegal, he dismissed them with a remark that revealed not only his personal philosophy, but the growing sentiment of ambitious military men everywhere. "Won't you stop citing laws to us who have swords by our sides?" And remember, a generation later, this was the man who defended the Republic against Caesar. Clearly, the rule of law was not long for this particular world. Having subdued Sicily, Pompey sailed next for Africa, where he defeated the scattered remnants of Sulla's enemies. For this last act, Pompey decided that he deserved a triumph. Where he got the idea that he deserved one is a mystery for the ages. Not only was he not old enough, he had not yet reached the minimum office required, praetor, to be considered for this greatest military honor, and in fact, had not even served in any public office at all. Finally, it had been a long-standing tradition that a triumph could not be approved if the battle or battles in question were against fellow Romans, which is, of course, what Pompey's African campaign was all about. It is from this impetuousness that Sulla hung the sarcastic title of Magnus on Pompey. "Ah, yes, Pompey the Great wants a triumph. Let's all bow before Pompey the Great." But Pompey was undeterred. He refused to disband his army until his request was granted. Sulla, partly to appease his wife and stepdaughter, who had married Pompey the year before, and partly out of a genuine fear of what Pompey may be capable of, approved the triumph. But Pompey would have to wait. First, Sulla held his own triumph, marching through the city to great fanfare and with much splendor. Next, Metellus Pius was granted his triumph, and the senior general marched through in similar splendor, but with slightly less fanfare. By the time Pompey's triumph rolled around, the city showed little enthusiasm for the event. What, another triumph? Boring. Sulla hoped he had put young Pompey in his place. But Sulla died before he realized that nothing would ever put Pompey in his place. It was not long after Sulla's death that the first in a long line of would-be despots arose in his wake. A consul named Lepidus decided after his term was complete that he was not ready to give up the reins of power and gathered an army in northern Italy to support his bid for a second term. Lepidus himself arrived in Rome with a great train of supporters, claiming that he controlled the land between the Po River and the Alps, and that his second consulship had better be approved, or else. The Senate had already sent Metellus Pius to Spain, where the last great Marian general, Quintus Sertorius, continued to hold out. So they sent young Pompey north to quell the brewing insurrection. It did not take long to scatter Lepidus's supposed army and send word to the city that it had nothing to fear. Lepidus, who fancied himself the next Sulla, was forced to flee from the city, never to return. After ending this threat from Lepidus, Pompey issued a demand to the Senate that was even more insane than his request for a triumph. He wrote that he wanted to be sent to Spain as proconsul with full imperium. Again, Pompey had never served an office a day in his life, and was yet 15 years away from being eligible for a consulship, let alone a proconsulship, which was reserved for men who had already, you know, served as consul. Pompey knew it was brash, But he also knew as well as the Senate did the situation on the ground in Spain. Metellus Pius, as great a general as he was, had been thus far unable to gain ground on the rogue Quintus Sertorius. It was clear that Pius needed help, and that Pompey was heads and shoulders better than anyone else Rome could possibly send as a reinforcement. With great reluctance, they approved Pompey's request and made him proconsul of Spain in 76 BC, at the tender age of 30. Crassus was, of course, appalled. Pompey remained in Spain for the next 5 years, engaged in a parallel rather than combined war effort alongside Metellus. Neither general had any wish to share the glory should one of them actually succeed in defeating the rebellious Sertorius, though neither had much to worry about as the Marian general ran circles around them both. Pompey began to tire of the cat-and-mouse game in Spain, and instead began to covet a command in the east, where Mithridates was once again making trouble for Rome. But extracting himself from Spain would not be so easy after the fuss he had made to get there in the first place. Besides, he had rivals back home that desired the eastern command for themselves and were doing everything in their power to make sure Pompey remained in Iberia, chasing his tail. But fortune smiled on Pompey once again, and in 71 BC, Sertorius was assassinated by an ambitious lieutenant who then took command of the rogue army for himself. But this lieutenant was not half the commander Sertorius had been, and in his first encounter with Pompey was defeated easily. Just like that, Pompey had liberated Spain. After lucking into this victory, Pompey took his army back to Italy just in time to luck into some more glory, scooping up for himself a good deal of undeserved credit for ending the slave revolt that had erupted in his absence. And of course, the credit he scooped up came at the expense of Crassus, who had done the yeoman's work in defeating the slave army led by a certain Thracian gladiator. Next week, we'll cover this famous slave revolt, led of course by Spartacus, who at one point stood at the head of 120,000 men and won multiple victories against the pride of the Roman legions. In the aftermath of the revolt, Pompey and Crassus would forge an uneasy alliance while some 5,000 captured slaves were crucified up and down the Appian Way, a lesson to those who would follow in Spartacus's footsteps. Finally, I would like to add that I've made a few changes behind the scenes here at the History of Rome. I've abandoned Blogger, which turned out to be the cause behind all the early episodes not showing up on iTunes, to a new blog at thehistoryofrome.typepad.com. Don't even get me started on what's wrong with WordPress. Also, at the prodding of some generous listeners, I've added a PayPal donation button to the new site. I never expected to gain anything financially from the History of Rome, but a few of you out there have expressed an interest in sending a few appreciative dollars my way for the effort. So, if you find yourself so inclined, there it is. Any amount you choose, Visa and MasterCard accepted, minus whatever the leg breakers at PayPal take as their cut. Thanks to all of you out there who have stuck with the show, and see you next week for Spartacus. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 36, I Am Spartacus. Last week, we traced the early career paths of Crassus and Pompey, leaving them both on the edge of political prominence. This week, we will cover the event that broke them into the big time. Prior to the Third Servile War, Crassus was just another fat cat, and Pompey was just another ambitious young man on the make. But after the slave revolt, both turned their well-deserved and not-so-well-deserved acclaim into a shared consulship. Acclaim, and the fact that both refused to stand down their armies until the Senate agreed to make sure the elections produced the result that was in everyone's best interest. In 73 BC, Pompey was in Spain trying to pin down the rebellious Marian general Quintus Sertorius, and Crassus was in Rome doing whatever it was that Crassus did, probably dickering with a drowning man over the price of tossing him a lifeline. Spartacus, though, was at gladiator school in Capua. He was supposed to be learning how to put on a good show for his Roman masters, but mostly he was plotting his escape. Kirk Douglas was born in New York in 1916 to illiterate Russian immigrants. His real name was Isuer Danielovich, but he spent his early years answering to the name of Izzy Dembski. He began acting in high school and knew from the moment he first stepped out on stage that he wanted to be an actor. Oh, wait a second. I think I may have mixed things up a bit. Hang on. Okay, I got it. No one is quite sure where Spartacus the Gladiator came from. It seems pretty clear that he was born somewhere in Greece, and he is most often referred to as a Thracian, but Thracian was also the gladiatorial combat style he practiced, so there may have been some confusion somewhere along the line about his true origins. It is also not known how he came to be in captivity, but he was widely believed to have served as an auxiliary soldier in the legions at some point, and he may have been a captured deserter. However it happened, it did not take long for the traitors to recognize that he would make a promising gladiator. Peter Ustinov purchased Spartacus and brought him to Capua to train for life in the arena at a gladiatorial school. In 73 BC, a plot was hatched at the school that eventually included some 200 gladiators and slaves to break out of captivity. However, with that many people involved, it was just a matter of time before someone talked. When the conspirators were confronted, after the inevitable squealer squealed, they decided to just go for it, and with whatever crude weapons they could grab, mostly kitchen utensils, about 70 fought their way out of the school. Initially, the escape mob had no leader, but a few in the group possessed the kind of natural authority men turn to in a crisis. One of these was, of course, Spartacus, but another, of equal standing at this point, was a Gaul named Crixus. The escapees showed more confidence and daring than one might expect from men on the run. They proceeded to raid the countryside around Capua, which, as you may recall from earlier episodes, was some of the richest, most fertile land in Italy. The majority of the Roman elites had country estates in the region. And of course, where there are palatial country estates, there are slaves, none of whom were too excited about their status. So, when the escaped gladiator showed up at the door demanding plunder, master slaves did not defend master's things. Master slaves joined up and helped carry off whatever they could. Pretty soon, the band had grown into the thousands, displaying the kind of sound judgment and strategic thinking that would make them such a formidable force. The group headed towards Mount Vesuvius, where they set up a stable camp on the densely wooded slopes. At first, the Senate looked upon the raiding as little more than common thievery and took no official notice. They did not realize that Spartacus and his compatriots were building an army. They did not realize that the Third Servile War had already begun. Now, I'm sure you're asking yourself, Third Servile War? What about the first two? So, let's back up a bit. The First and Second Servile Wars were both contained to Sicily, and I mentioned the former in passing during the episode on Tiberius Gracchus when I was ticking off some of the reasons grain prices in Rome were skyrocketing at the time. That war lasted from 135 to 132 BC and was the result of the barbaric treatment shown to the island's slave population after Rome took full control of the island in the aftermath of the Punic Wars. The Second Servile War broke out a generation later while Marius recruited for his showdown with the Cimbri in 104 BC. After some local provincial rulers across the empire complained that they were unable to supply their recruit quotas because all of their ablest recruits, read, poor young men, had been chained up and sold into slavery by overzealous Roman debt collectors. So Marius ordered the release of any slave from an allied nation. This was great as far as it went, but in Sicily, many slaves took this to mean that they were free and were quite displeased when they were ordered to return to their masters. So a force of about 25,000 formed a coherent army and broke out into open revolt. Both slave uprisings were eventually quelled, but only after great effort and expense. So the Roman Senate, despite having previously witnessed two slave revolts, did not yet recognize what was happening in Campania was in fact another slave revolt. They dispatched an irregular militia of about 3,000, led by one of that year's praetors, Gaius Claudius Glauber, down to round up the fugitives and put a halt to the looting. Glauber located the slave hideout on the slopes of Mount Vesuvius and settled into a camp at the base of the mountain. Everyone knew there was only one safe way to come down Vesuvius, because the back end of the mountain was all cliffs. The slaves would eventually get hungry, come down to forage, and when they did, the militia would envelop them, and Glauber would be welcomed home a hero. QED. Except that the slave army had no time for conventional wisdom or standard military practice. During the night, they used vines from the trees and handmade ladders to rappel down the sheer cliffs. While Glauber slept, dreams of a consulship dancing in his head, the slaves approached from behind, surprised the militia, and killed them all. Upon receiving the news, the Roman Senate was nonplussed. The slaves were making a big old mess of everyone's favorite vacation spot, and it was frankly getting annoying. They weren't quite ready to commit the full force of the legions, so another militia of about 4,000 was sent down, but for some reason, the commander decided to split this force into two before engaging the outlaw slaves. Both halves were too weak on their own, and the slaves defeated the new militia with ease. So, not only had the slaves now won three successive battles against the Romans, but they also had the armor, weapons, and equipment that had been sent down along with the 7,000 militiamen. Suddenly, they were a true force to be reckoned with, and slaves from across the countryside, men, women, and children, flocked to the growing, now formidable slave army. The 70 who had initially broken out of the gladiator school found themselves backed up by 70,000 of their closest friends. As the winter of 73 BC approached, Rome had a very big problem on its hands, and it wasn't going anywhere anytime soon. The slaves spent the winter continuing to raid the countryside with impunity and, most importantly, train. Their survival now depended on their ability to stand against the Roman legions on the open battlefield. The core group of mostly Gallic gladiators would individually train groups of new recruits to block, parry, thrust, march, and most importantly, follow orders. Those newly trained individuals would then go off and train their own groups, who would, in turn, train yet more groups. Using this exponential system of training, by the time the campaign season of 72 finally came around, the slaves were ready. And it was a good thing, too, because Rome wasn't going to be sending militias this time. No, this time it would be full consular armies. By most accounts, Spartacus's main aim was to make his way north and get out of Italy. His fellow commander Crixus, however, seemed much more enamored with a life spent pillaging the Roman countryside. So while Spartacus led the bulk of the newly minted army north, Crixus peeled off with about 30,000, the plan being for them to stay in southern Italy and suck up whatever wasn't nailed down. His reasoning, I suppose, was that Rome hadn't been able to stop them so far, and now they were stronger and better equipped. So Crixus was going to get his before he retired. But regular legions are not drafted militias, and untested praetors are not seasoned consuls. And Rome had decided the slave revolt was the business at hand for 72 BC, and sent both consuls for the year, Lucius Gellius Publicola and Gnaeus Cornelius Lentulus, at the head of full consular armies to put down what they now finally recognized to be a full-blown revolt. Crixus and his force did not last very long. Gellius caught up with him, and the far more disciplined Romans were able to carve their way through the mostly Germanic infantry with ease. At least two-thirds of Crixus's army was killed in the battle, including Crixus himself. Spartacus, meanwhile, continued to march north towards the Alps. And there are two divergent accounts of what happened next. According to the historian Appian, writing in about 160 AD, Lentulus placed his army between Spartacus and the Alps, while Gellius, fresh off his victory over Crixus, followed Spartacus north. The consuls hoped to trap the slaves between their two armies and crush them. But Spartacus acted quickly and decided to attack Lentulus before Gellius was able to arrive and close the trap. The slave army defeated Lentulus's outnumbered legion, whereupon Spartacus wheeled around when Gellius arrived and beat his army too. Then, just to top things off, the two defeated consular armies regrouped and combined, whereupon Spartacus defeated them again. I call this version Spartacus Totally Rules, starring Spartacus. The Greek historian Plutarch, on the other hand, writing around 100 AD, says simply that Spartacus faced Lentulus and defeated him before meeting and beating another small Roman legion at the foot of the Alps. No mention is made of facing Gellius or the subsequent third battle. My suspicion is that the latter version, which I call probably closer to the truth, was probably closer to the truth. But whatever exactly happened in 72, the sources pretty much agree on what happened next. Crassus entered the picture and brought the Third Servile War to a brutal conclusion. The big gaping hole in the story, though, is having most likely defeated Lentulus and with nothing standing between him and freedom, why did Spartacus decide to turn around and head back into Italy? And this gets into the real lack of an answer for what the motivations behind the revolt really were. Crispus's motives seemed clear. He wanted to kill Romans and take their stuff. Spartacus obviously had some divergent motivation, or he would have kept the army whole, but if he did, why fight all the way to the Alps just to turn around? We will probably never know why Spartacus turned around, but in any event he did, and the army marched back south. With the failure of the consuls the previous year to get the job done, though Gellius pretty clearly seemed to have done his part, Crassus saw his chance to win some of that glory that had so eluded him by putting down the revolt himself. He convinced the Senate to give him the title of praetor and command of 50,000 troops, more than enough, he said, to defeat the rabble once and for all. Crassus, by all accounts, was a strict disciplinarian, even going so far as to bring back the old tradition of decimation, by which every 10th soldier of a retreating legion is executed. He definitely came from the old school of thought that the soldiers ought to fear their officers more than the enemy. It didn't endear him to anyone, and Crassus never enjoyed the kind of love and adulation that Caesar or Pompey basked in, but at least this time it got the job done. Spartacus led his slave army south, all the way to the very toe of Italy, and began to negotiate for passage across the Straits of Messina to Sicily. Obviously, Sicily had given birth to the first two servile wars, so it seems that Spartacus may have intended to lead a general revolt on the island, acquire new recruits, and, let's say, overthrow the Roman Empire. His wider strategic plans are a complete mystery. All we know is what he did, not why he did it. Being the leader of an outlaw army, he was forced to deal with Sicilian pirates as his only option for ferrying the army off the mainland. But having paid the pirates did what pirates normally do. They took the money and ran. This left Spartacus lighter in the pocketbook, but, more importantly, up the proverbial creek without a paddle. The toe of Italy is not particularly wide, so as Spartacus was trying to flee Italy by sea, Crassus marched his army down to prevent the slaves from backtracking by land. When the pirates betrayed him, Spartacus was trapped. There is some indication that Spartacus attempted to bargain with Crassus at this point, but Crassus would have none of it. He wasn't simply interested in bringing the revolt to an end. He was interested in defeating the slave army militarily. Crassus had more important things to worry about than the ultimate safety of the Roman people. He had his political career to look out for, and he was banking on a great military victory to catapult him into the upper echelon of the nobility. Negotiate? The consulship was just a day's battle away. Spartacus and his army were in desperate straits. Hemmed in by Crassus's legions, word also began to filter through the lines that Roman reinforcements were arriving from the east, and that Pompey had crossed back into Italy and was heading south to aid Crassus. Spartacus decided that they had to break through Crassus's line now, or they would have no hope at all. He concentrated all his strength on one point, and eventually his army was able to break through the line, running at full steam to escape the toe of Italy before the reinforcements could arrive. But the escape effort, combined with the nearly 2 years of continuous struggle and hardship, had finally taken their toll on the unprofessional slave army. 15,000 men were separated from the main force led by Spartacus and were destroyed by Crassus and his pursuing legions. Discipline broke down in the slave army as groups began to flee or fight depending on their own disposition. Realizing that he would not be able to keep his army together for much longer, Spartacus decided to make a last stand. His army turned and threw everything it had at Crassus, but it simply wasn't enough. The majority of the slave army, along with Spartacus himself, were killed in the final battle. Crassus had put down the revolt and stood as the conquering hero of the Third Servile War, and he wouldn't have to share his glory with anybody. Except that about 5,000 slaves had managed to evade capture and continue running north. Pompey was on his way south with instructions to aid Crassus against the great and terrible slave menace. Not making it in time for the main battle, he instead ran right into these 5,000 fleeing slaves. Exhausted, ill-equipped, and on their last legs, Pompey barely broke a sweat defeating this last remnant of Spartacus's already defeated army. But, master of PR that he was, Pompey sent a message to the Senate announcing that he, Pompey Magnus, had officially brought the uprising to an end. While the honors were being handed out after the legions returned to Rome, Pompey stood side by side with Crassus, accepting credit for things he very obviously did not deserve credit for. The victory over the slave army was supposed to establish Crassus as the preeminent leader of the Republic, but instead he now shared that distinction with Pompey, much to the former's chagrin and the latter's delight. But the enmity Crassus now bore Pompey was not strong enough to make him miss an obvious political opportunity. Both men stood at the head of large armies, camped outside the city walls, and neither was particularly disposed to disband them until an understanding was reached. They each knew that the other would be their biggest rival for power, but also that there were dozens of other nobles who fancied themselves the next Sulla. So first, you have to eliminate the pretenders to the throne before you can deal with the real claimants. So Crassus, Pompey, and the Senate agreed that it was in everyone's best interest for Crassus and Pompey to serve as co-consuls for the next year. From there, it would be easy for them to eliminate the weaker competition before inevitably turning on each other to decide the final fate of Rome. Who knew that some impoverished noble named Julius Caesar would wind up beating them both? The slave revolt led by Spartacus was the last such revolt in Roman history. Crassus would probably tell you that it was the fact that he ordered 6,000 recaptured slaves crucified along the Appian Way as the reason why. You see, though he ordered them crucified, he declined to order that the bodies be removed. The decomposing corpses, then skeletons, served as a stark reminder to slaves everywhere what happens if they forget their place in the world. More likely, though, it was the shifting undercurrents of the Roman economy and Roman politics. The bulk of the Roman wars of territorial expansion, where slaves came from, were now a thing of the past. So not only would there be fewer slaves in the future, but those slaves would inevitably become a more precious commodity. The rampant mistreatment that had characterized the master-slave relationship previously shifted into something more humane. Eventually, in the empire, it would actually become a crime to kill a slave. Imagine that, not being able to destroy your own property. How uncivilized. The declining slave population changed the dynamic. So while slavery was still a terrible thing to endure, it was not so bad that huge armies would spontaneously spring up to threaten the peace. No, for the next few hundred years, it is pretty safe to say that the greatest threat to the peace was not revolting slaves or invading foreign armies, but rather the rampant scheming of ambitious nobles to put themselves in charge of the greatest empire the Western world had ever known. It was a race to see who could kill the 500-year-old Republic first, and next week we will cover one of the more infamous plots, deadly in purpose, but ultimately hilarious in execution, the Conspiracy of Catiline. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 38, The Catiline Conspiracy. There were dozens of contributing factors to the breakdown of the old Republican order in the first century BC, some economic, some administrative, some martial. But what was really at issue was a sickness that had taken hold at the very root of the political system. Until now, the quasi-religious sovereignty of the electoral process and the officials it produced was unquestioned. If you ran for consul and lost, that was it. You had lost. Maybe your political career was dead, and maybe you would run again someday. But you abided by the decision. When the Senate handed down decrees or the tribunes passed laws, maybe you didn't like it, and maybe you did everything in your power to get them repealed, but there was a way things were done. Maybe it entered into your head to do something about those so-and-sos down in the forum, and maybe after too much to drink, the conversation turned to topics like assassination and military coups, the latter no doubt a favorite topic amongst landless veterans for the whole of Roman history. But in the morning, everyone sobered up. The inertia of the system was simply too great to overcome. While there is ample evidence of political assassination directed at threats to the old order, the Gracchi being the most famous example, there is scant record of extra-legal killing directed at the old order. But by the first century BC, whatever spell that held ambitious men in check when they didn't get their way had been broken. The corruption that had taken hold at all rungs of society, the kickbacks enjoyed by provincial governors, the bribery that secured lucrative posts and favorable court rulings, the cash-for-vote schemes that more and more determined the outcome of elections, had finally reached the heart of the system. An entire generation of men had grown up in the shadow of Marius and Sulla. No amount of democratic whitewashing could hide the truth. Power sprang from the sword. And for those bold enough and strong enough to seize what they could not legitimately earn, it was understood that power had a way of retroactively legitimizing even the most illegitimate of actions. The only rule was power, by any means necessary. Because once in power, the rules could be changed, and those who disagreed could be eliminated. Oz the Great and Terrible had been seen through, and the man behind the curtain exposed. Cicero, the most persuasive speaker of his day, and perhaps in all of Roman history, spent his entire career imploring his countrymen to pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. But words are no match for action. And those of us with the swords, as Pompey so aptly described his brethren, were busy plotting how to kill the man behind the curtain, become the man behind the curtain, and become Rome itself. Rome, the great and terrible. Lucius Sergius Catilina, known to history as Catiline, attempted in 63 BC to kill the man behind the curtain. His half-baked scheme never got off the ground, but his story touches on nearly every major player in the subsequent years of civil war in Rome. And while his plot was foiled, the sheer volume of willing accomplices shocked polite company, and reminded those with similar ambition that one of these days the Republic was going to snap in two, and the important thing was not to save it, but to make sure that you came out on top when the bow finally broke. Catiline was born in 108 BC to an ancient patrician family. While he came from a line of consuls and thus would never be considered a new man, the last of those consuls had served in the 380s BC. So Catiline carried with him all the arrogance of a well-pedigreed aristocrat, while simultaneously bearing the insecurity of knowing his family had been trading on a name that no one in recent memory had done much to earn. This would turn out to be a dangerous combination. Catiline was intent on returning his family to glory. He was bright, energetic, and charismatic, a natural leader, brave in the field, and savvy in the forum. There was no good reason why he should not be able to lead his family out of the political wilderness, and indeed his career began promisingly enough, if only he had been a good man. He entered public life by way of the social wars, serving with distinction under the command of Pompey Strabo, and alongside young Pompey Magnus and the man who would become his arch-rival, Marcus Tullius Cicero. During the years of conflict between Marius and Sulla, Catiline did his best to keep his head down. He was neither important enough to be courted, nor important enough to be disposed of. Semi-obscurity can be your best friend in times of civil strife. But once Sulla returned from the east, Catiline was one of those officially neutral aristocrats who knew which way the winds were blowing, and he publicly backed the incoming dictator. He served in a variety of administrative posts overseas after Sulla's retirement, and the young man seemed well-positioned for an honorable career. But as is often the case, the true character of a man will eventually come out, and how he deals with adversity is often the best time to gauge what that true character is. In 73 BC, Catiline was accused of adultery, and not just run-of-the-mill adultery, but adultery committed with a Vestal virgin, a very serious offense. But at the trial, one of the leading men of the day and leader of the aristocratic party testified on behalf of Catiline. Character witnessing was a far more potent legal force in Rome than it is today, and with the word of Quintus Catulus backing him, Catiline was acquitted. Now, why one of the most important men in Rome would put his own name on the line for a minor noble was a curiosity. The Roman chattering classes assumed bribery played a role. So in his first real test, Catiline seems to have chosen to circumvent the rules and subvert Rome's judicial system rather than directly face whatever consequences he was in store for. It was a pattern that would repeat itself throughout his career. But with the bullet successfully dodged, Catiline went on to serve as praetor in 68 BC and then pro-praetor in Africa the next 2 years. In 66 BC, he entered his name as a candidate for the consulship, but the censors denied his eligibility. A minor legal technicality barred his entrance into the race, namely that the citizens of Africa were accusing him of abuse of power, of using public resources for private gain, and taking kickbacks. Furiously denying the charges, Catalan was enraged that his name was being dragged through the mud, but there was nothing he could do. He would have to wait until the matter was cleared up to run for consul again. In 65 BC, he stood trial for abuse of power and was once again acquitted when a number of leading men vouched for his character. Shiny, precious character. The skeleton of Catiline's career to this point is a matter of public record, but a few of the more unsavory details are filled in by Cicero in his famous denunciation, and later by the historian Sallust, who painted the entire Catilinian affair as a morality tale, with Catiline starring as the despicable enemy of the public good. So it is sometimes hard to tell how many of his actions were real and how many were embellished or made up out of whole cloth. For example, there is a story of an initial conspiracy that has Catiline planning the murder of half the Senate. And even men at the time believed this episode resided only in Cicero's politically motivated imagination. Certainly Catiline was not connected to any such plot by the time he was allowed to run for the consulship the following year in 64 BC. As much as Cicero seems to have genuinely hated Catiline, he really ought to have cut him some slack. If it hadn't been for Catiline, it is likely that Cicero never would have won election and earned the consulship that he had been striving for his whole life. With Catiline running on a platform of debt cancellation and promising the sun, moon, and stars to any poor sod who would listen, the nobility had no choice but to throw their support behind the provincial novus homo who had an unhealthy obsession with philosophy, Marcus Tullius Cicero. Sure, he was a pleb who was not even a true Roman, but he was the most conservative of the available candidates, and at least argued for the continued dominance of the Senate in political affairs. Cicero had been born in Arpium, 60 miles south of Rome. True, the region had long been a part of Rome, and its population had been granted full citizenship not long after the end of the Second Punic War. But Cicero was never allowed to forget that he was a mere provincial. And not just a provincial, but a pleb provincial. He could trace to no ancestors, and would have to rely on his own drive to battle his way up the Roman political ladder. Luckily, he was one of the most gifted men of his generation. From the start, he was recognized as a brilliant student, and his family made sure that he received the finest education they could afford. Like most of the nobility, he was fluent in both Greek and Latin, and devoured Hellenistic philosophy. More than any other man, Cicero was responsible for the full integration of Greek thought into Roman life, translating mountains of Greek literature into Latin and promoting its study endlessly. As I said at the very beginning of this series, the Romans were never particularly disposed to invention and creativity, but they were masters of co-option and assimilation. In Rome, no good idea went unadopted, and in Greece, Cicero saw good ideas everywhere. But as much as he contributed to the cultural enrichment of Rome, Cicero saw himself primarily as a politician and pointed to his political career above his philosophical or legal pursuits as the achievement he was most proud of. After serving in the legions with resigned ill humor during the Social War, Cicero started his legal career in the 80s BC, quickly garnering a reputation as a great orator. But after defending a man in a murder trial and pointing the finger at a sullen ally while Sulla still sat on the throne, Cicero took a pragmatic extended tour of Greece until the affair blew over. While in Greece, he was put into contact with the masters of Greek philosophy and rhetoric, and Cicero perfected a unique oratorical style that would make him the acknowledged master of his day. In 75 BC, he was elected quaestor for Sicily and endeared himself to the locals for his relatively honest dealings. They ultimately asked him to take on a politically dangerous case, prosecuting the Roman governor of Sicily on charges of corruption. Cicero finally agreed and spun the trial into his big break, successfully prosecuting the governor, whose corruption far exceeded the acceptable standards of the day. From that point on, he was on the fast track, achieving every step of the cursus honorum in his year, finally winning the consulship in 64 BC for a term to be served the following year. Catiline, though defeated by Cicero in that election, was undeterred and ran again the next year. But amidst a trial for his role in the Sullan purges spearheaded by Cato the Younger, and a lack of support from his wealthy benefactors, Crassus among them, who had supported him as an antidote to senatorial domination, Catiline's last campaign never got off the ground. his career was effectively over. And had he been born in another age, he may have sulked and raged, but would have gone on with his life and found other outlets for his passions. But in this age, he was able to see his final defeat as merely an advisory decision. And more importantly, he was able to find other men who were ready to help him expose the man behind the curtain. Catiline began to conspire actively with other disaffected citizens. Their aim was simple: overthrow the government. Now, Catiline was motivated by personal delusions of grandeur and driven to such extreme measures out of an inflamed sense of bitterness. The men he gathered around his plot, however, were almost uniformly brought on board out of a base material self-interest. From the upper classes, he found indebted nobles and corrupt ex-senators who had been purged from their roles by the censors, men who wanted power but couldn't have it, and men who owed money but didn't want to repay it. Catiline promised them access back to control and a cancellation of all debts once he was in charge. From the lower classes, he stoked the bitterness of landless veterans and indebted commoners. Up and down the line, the message was the same: once we overthrow the government, everyone will get everything they ever desired. Land, money, power. The whole kit and caboodle. This was not an ideological revolution. This was naked self-interest writ large. In Etruria, an ex-centurion named Gaius Manlius began gathering an army. It is unclear how connected Manlius and Catiline were at this point, but it speaks volumes that when Catiline was exiled after his plot was exposed, he headed straight for the force Manlius had assembled. In Rome, the plan was to kick off the coup by assassinating Cicero. From there, strategically located conspirators would begin setting fires across the city and generally plunge Rome into chaos. At least, that's what Cicero reported to the Senate the day after he was notified of the assassination plot. Cicero's informants had apparently gotten word to the consul of the threat, and Cicero posted extra guards, foiling the would-be assassins. There's a great deal of ambiguity about whether any of this is true, but Cicero outlined the whole affair so eloquently and blamed Catiline so thoroughly that the Senate came to believe the charges. Famously, as the Senate listened to Cicero, they moved one by one away from Catiline, who was eventually left sitting by himself, physically and politically isolated. I'm not exaggerating when I say that Cicero's Catilinarian orations are still held up today as some of the finest rhetoric ever uttered by man. Now, how much Cicero was exaggerating is another story completely. There is speculation that while Catiline was indeed up to something, the assassination attempt may have been invented by Cicero to secure the near-dictatorial powers he needed to deal with the alleged crisis. It is further speculated that he wanted those powers not to deal with the specific machinations of Catiline and his conspirators, but rather to lay the groundwork for a defense of the Republic against Pompey, who was presently on his way home from the east at the head of a large veteran army and with more money at his disposal than the Roman treasury had ever held. Cicero wanted to make sure that any internal strife in Rome was quashed before Pompey returned. Both Marius and Sulla had been able to exploit political divisions in the city in their quest for power. Cicero wanted to deny Pompey a similar opportunity. Catiline, now a pariah, agreed to go into exile, but lied about his destination and instead headed for Etruria to join Manlius's growing army. But for now, the coup was still on, even without Catiline overseeing the operation in Rome. But the remaining conspirators were not particularly adept at their jobs. They attempted to entice a group of Gallic emissaries to join their cause, but the visiting Gauls simply took the opportunity to earn the goodwill of the Senate by exposing the plot. They talked five of the leading conspirators into affixing their name to a letter promising the Gauls they were fully committed to rebellion. The careless plotters forgot the first and second rule of Fight Club, and when the Gauls presented the document to the Senate, the five men were arrested, and the conspiracy inside Rome was short-circuited. Cicero and Cato led the charge in the Senate to have the men executed at once. Julius Caesar opposed the death sentence, arguing that exile was preferable. It would not set a good precedent to have men of senatorial rank executed without trial. But with Cicero and Cato arguing that punishment must be swift and harsh, the Senate relented and ordered the five strangled. For the rest of his career, Cicero's enemies would bring up this bloodthirsty and illegal railroading of Roman citizens against him. Cicero's exile during the chaos of the subsequent years would be based largely on his actions towards the five conspirators on that day. Certainly, his actions subtly undercut every argument he would ever make about the need to respect the rule of law and the constitution of Rome. With the inside men gone, the whole plot quickly imploded. Mass desertions from the insurgent army forced Manlius and Catiline to lead those left around the countryside, studiously avoiding the legions they encountered. Eventually, though, they were cornered and forced to fight. The rebels, little more than a mob, were destroyed. Sallust makes a point of reporting that Catiline was killed while fighting on the front lines, and unlike many of his men, died of frontal wounds, not wounds in the back, the dishonorable sign that a man had turned to run. The final verdict on Catiline was that he was a courageous, ambitious, and corrupt man who concocted a plot far more ambitious than his abilities warranted. He was forced to ally himself with the dregs of both Roman nobility and the lower classes, and he was easily bested by better men. He was outmaneuvered by Cicero at nearly every step, never standing a chance against Rome's greatest politician. The conspiracy of Catiline was an instant legend in Roman history, both for the central role played by Cicero and because it provided a blueprint for how not to organize a coup. Julius Caesar, of course, was right there the whole time, no doubt taking notes, mental or otherwise. I like to imagine that somewhere in those notes, in big bold letters, is the line, "Make sure Cicero is out of the way." Next week, Julius Caesar, young senator on the rise, will make his first attempt to make sure that Cicero is out of the way, not by attacking him, but by asking him to join an informal alliance of mutual support that was being formed between Crassus, Pompey, and Caesar. Cicero refused the invitation, correctly identifying the first triumvirate, as it came to be known, as a mortal enemy of the Republic he so loved. Initially, the threat came primarily from Pompey and Crassus, with Caesar seen as little more than a pawn in their game. But the first triumvirate would spell the end of the Republic, not for the power it gave Pompey and Crassus, but for the money and support that it gave Caesar, in whom, you may recall, Sulla saw many a Marius. There will probably be no episode next week, as I'm scheduled to fly to visit the history of Roman laws for what they call Christmas, but what we all know is the Feast of the Unconquered Sun. However, as I sit here, Portland has been crippled by severe weather, so who knows if I'll ever actually make it out of town. So if there's no episode, you've been warned, and if there is, happy Saturnalia.